Amen. Merry Christmas, Christ Church at the Grove. Hallelujah. So good to have each and every one of you here with us. And you guys, from our announcement sheet, if you would focus your attention there real quick. Amen. Again, a blessed Christmas day. This is as far away from a Sunday as Christmas can be, in that we know Christmas is on Saturday. Okay? You guys, let me point out that those of us thinking of attending upstairs with Kimballsville United Methodist Church and their Christmas Eve service on Friday at 7, it may or may not happen. If you're thinking of coming, you might do well to give me a call and ask if it's still on, okay? As things keep changing throughout our nation, throughout the world, so you want to pay close attention. Alrighty? Amen. With that, let me also acknowledge that our Christmas program, our children's ministry Christmas program, which we normally do on the Sunday before Christmas, has been postponed. Okay? And you, let me give you an update on Nicole. Thank God she is has not had severe symptoms, okay, of COVID. Amen. Thank God. Amen. And that at least to date, the boys and Justin seem to be fine. They have tested and they're negative. So we are thankful for that. We'll keep praying for them. And we'll keep you posted on when we have the children's program. Okay? I am glad that in the midst of so much festivities around Christmas, that we are a people who acknowledge Christ every day. Amen. Right. So you guys, it's always a good time for us to be reminded of God in flesh. Whether it's at Christmas time or whether it's sometime in January or whether it's in the middle of July. We are the God people. Amen? Amen. And let me remind you, at this time of year, with New Year's around the corner, we invite you to join us in reading the Bible through the course of a year. And I promote these Bible reading charts, which puts the Bible in chronological order. And we have them available. They'll be up front here. Should you like to give it a try? Amen. How many of you have given it a try? Amen. That's awesome. Amen. How many of you have made it? Oh, good. You guys, you'll never make it if you don't give it a try. Amen. So I encourage you. Sometimes I think this is the best thing that I do as a minister, simply encourage people to read the Bible for themselves. Alrighty? So these are up front here, if you would like those. Further update, the heating system is almost completely done. Okay? Amen. We thank God. No more further complications, and so far winter has been very mild. Have you noticed? Okay. Consequently, you guys, you know, we've been struggling a little bit. For some of you, it may be a little warm in here right now. It's pretty much set at what we always have it set at, 69. When it gets colder outside, it probably feel a little bit not as warm. Okay, so just hang in there with us. Amen. How many of you have come to focus on Christ? Okay, amen. All right. You guys, let me say that it is so nice to have my family here today. Okay. And Natalie, amen. Everybody, you know, here's Lisette that we have, amen, all the time. We're so thankful for that. This is our other daughter, Natalie, that is currently residing in Florida. Natalie, if you want to stand and just wave. Okay. Amen. And then this is her fiance, Dave. Amen. Dave, why don't you stand and wave? Okay. And these are the wonderful children. They can stand up and turn around and wave. Yeah. Hallelujah. So you get a chance to talk to them after the service. Alrighty. And see the nice little ring on Nani's finger. Amen. Folks, yesterday I had the privilege, as most of you know, Moiselle and Sally Ravert got married yesterday. Amen. So they are now Mr. and Mrs. Robinson. So when they come back, you may congratulate them. Alrighty? Hallelujah. Folks, and with that, the changes, they keep a coming. Amen. So good to see the Sangsters with us again this week, as we have Nathaniel, who we get to keep, and his wonderful family. The only brother that we still have at this time would be Mark. So make sure you say hello to Mark, because come tomorrow, he'll be flying out. And amen. How many of you have relatives coming in? Any of you have relatives coming in? So, okay, the Warners do. And are any of you going to relatives in the next couple of days? So that, right, oh, very good. That's nice. Yes. You guys, may God bless you in your travels. God keep you safe. God keep you in health. We're going to pray, you guys, and then we're going to turn it back over for a time of worship. We want to pray for Nicole and family, that they continue to do well in their healing process. You guys, we're going to remember Rob Lloyd's sister, Joyce, who is undergoing surgery. Amen. God knows the details. But we want to lift up Joyce. God knows who she is. All right. Thank God for Monica's dad that is progressing well. You guys, and let us pray also for Connie Frezzo. All right, these days she's not doing as well as she had been, and it's just hard for us to, you know, Connie, God bless her. I don't know if she's watching right now, but I'm acknowledge Connie's up there in age, and she has done so well for so long that we kind of keep anticipating. But you know, Connie's old enough not to do well physically. So we're going to pray for Connie, and one more person I want you to remember, and that would be Elaine Copeland, okay, Melanie's mother. You guys, they had an activity at Twin Pines, okay, Twin Pines is a nursing facility, where they gave them cards and just asked them to send a card to somebody. What it says here, Pastor Ben's Church. Amen. I think she kind of forgot. It's Christ Church at the Grove. But it says on the envelope, I love you all. And she sent us a little Christmas card. Okay, Sister Elaine is in 90, anyone know? How? Seven. Yeah, Sister Elaine's 97. And still very lucid, and you can visit her and have a nice conversation. On the inside, it simply says, let the love of the Christ child live in your heart this Christmas. Love, Elaine Copeland. Isn't that beautiful? God bless. So we're going to pray for Elaine and our friends at Twin Pines, okay? That they would enjoy themselves, even in their stage of life, as we celebrate Jesus Christ. So join me in praying, and feel free to pray for your individual needs right now. Amen. Precious Lord, what a privilege. Lord, is our entire society, Lord, really the entire world, Lord, at this time of year, Lord, pauses and more than they probably realize are acknowledging you. Lord, we're thankful, God, that we know you all the time. Lord, that you are real to us in our lives on a daily basis. But Lord, we too are especially thankful, Lord, during this time of year, as we reflect upon your great sacrifice. Lord, really, your humiliation is showing up as part of the creation in the form of man. Lord, ultimately to lay down your life for us. Lord, and with that, dear God, we have hope both in this life and in the life to come. Lord, right now, Savior, because of that hope, Lord, because by your stripes we are healed, Lord, we ask you, dear God, to be with the Swain family, Nicole in particular, Lord Gabe and Caleb and Michael and Justin. Lord, help Nicole to continue to heal. Lord, we pray, dear God, that you would keep the other family members, Lord, from contracting COVID. Lord, we pray for Joyce, Lord, in this upcoming surgery, Lord, major. And Lord, may she be focused on you. Lord, use Rob, use Sandy, dear God, to minister, Lord, to her and to the family. Dear Lord, we lift up Connie Frezzo. Lord, we lift up Elaine Copeland. Lord, hear the names of loved ones right now, Lord, that we're familiar with. Savior, blessing on Mr. and Mrs. Robinson. Lord, this is their first full day of married life again. Jesus, we commit ourselves to you right now. Lord, may you have your way with us. Lord, may this time together bring glory and honor to you, Lord, as it is due to your name. These things we pray in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Folks, when the service is done, Sister Sally, where would you like the ladies that are participating to meet? Okay, well, out there in the little library area, the little reading room area, okay? Ladies, if you came prepared to do your little exchange, you'll stop in there, okay? And I think Brother Andrew has a announcement. God bless him. And I'm gonna ask my wife to join me because I know what this announcement is. Wendy.
Good morning, Christ Church at the Grove.
Good morning.
This is our opportunity to bless Ben and Wanda. God has blessed this church tremendously over the last couple years, especially this year. Being a board member, knowing what we were going into here, how God has financially blessed this church is, I could tell you stories and give you amounts from folks that I've never heard of before. God has blessed us, and even more so than the financial blessings is the blessings of leadership from Pastor Ben and Sister Wanda. Two more sincere, genuine folks I don't know that I know. And I'm very grateful for your continued leadership and dedication to us. And hopefully that'll go for at least another year. So thank you both.
Christmas. The miracle of Christ in us, his grace, love, and power is the great wonder of each and every moment. May God richly bless you with his love in this beautiful season and with the joyful anticipation of his presence through all the new year brings. Merry Christmas. May Christ be born afresh within you both this holiday season, so grateful for your continued leadership and dedication to Christ at CCG. God bless your CCG family. We just want to thank you guys just for coming out. Like as Andrew said, to me, it fills my heart to see the pews starting to fill up again. And we understand where people are at, and we respect where they're at. Our hope and our desire is that whether you're here physically, whether you're able to see online, that you get God. Because it's not about us. The most important thing is that you are founded and grounded in Christ Jesus, because he's the one that has made the supreme sacrifice. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Folks, let me just say that we always appreciate, the extra blessing. But I want to thank you for loving us well all the time. Amen. Every day. You are a pleasure most of the time, as I am, hopefully, to you. So with that, you guys, let me acknowledge Bill Spencer. So nice to see Bill, and always nice to see Marsha, but Bill's here. Amen. And not to be taken for granted, worshiping with us today. Right. So folks, now we're just going to have our kind of regular service. I'm almost thankful that it's not the kind of hectic, with the children's program, and that's coming. A lot of energy and nervousness and whatnot. But you guys, just to be able to take a deep breath and say, God, here I am again. And more importantly, here you are again. And to meet with him. Alrighty? So enjoy yourself as we just enter into a time of worship. You can stand if you care to. You can sit. You can clap your hands if you're comfortable raising them and you want to raise them in worship. Amen. It's all good. It's how we handle it, okay? So however it helps you, if you just want to bow your head and meditate as they're singing, then you can do that. But do meet with Christ. It's the reason he came. You're the reason he came. You're the reason he came to this world. Meet with him. Praise God. Thank you. God. Amen. We thank the worship team. Amen. For leading us in worship this morning and those beautiful worship songs. Folks, and I hope that as you listen, you know, on the radio all this week and, you know, apart from the ones that focus so much on, I guess, you know, Santa Claus, but the songs that talk about Jesus. You know, joy to the world. Lord has come. I mean, they're going to be playing it on the radio. Amen. Those are Christ songs. And we should recognize that and rejoice to hear so many acknowledging him. I just hope, you guys, that for us, it's a personal acknowledgement, that it kind of makes our hearts leap to hear so many proclaiming the Christ. Amen. Our offering baskets, you guys, if you've come prepared to give today, as you know, we just have them on that back round table. There's these two baskets. Amen. That's where you just deposit. Amen. If you've come prepared to give. With that, I'm going to dismiss our children's ministry. Okay? So here's where we lose a lot of energy. Okay? And amen. I know that children's ministry is meeting. Is the youth meeting? No, so the youth will stay here. Okay. Folks, I got good news for you. I think I'm going to be shorter today. Good. No applause. I like that. But God bless our teachers and their willingness to have to be flexible in the light of change, because again, today was supposed to be our Christmas program. Okay. Let me find my notes. I'm not going to panic. Don't panic for me. They're in here somewhere. There you go. Matthew 17. Matthew chapter 17. And this was something that on a Wednesday night several weeks ago, as we've been going through the Gospels and comparing Matthew's and Mark and Luke and John's story about the life of Christ, noticing what things were, you know, some are specific, only one Gospel writer mentions them, others, all four mention them. In Matthew 17, you have one of three versions. Mark has a version, Luke has a version. In other words, they tell the story of this incident. Okay? But I'm just going to read the Matthew version. As at that time, we learned a couple of things. I was reminded of some things and learned a couple of new things. And ever since then, I just couldn't help but notice how much the same thought keeps coming back to me. So with that, let me read Matthew 17, verses 1 through 8. There's a lot there. We're not going to focus on a lot of the detail. But I want to start here, where it says that after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and he led them up a high mountain by themselves. So this is the adult Jesus, okay? He is 30-some years old. He has grown up since the little manger. And there, he, talking about Jesus, was transfigured, is the word that is used. Transfigured means a change. If you transfigure something, it had a certain likeness, but now it's got a different one. So Jesus was transfigured before them. And it gives a little description. His face shone like the sun. His face normally didn't shine like the sun. Okay? He did not walk around with a halo. He would have looked like we're looking right now. But that day, his face shone. That's part of the transfiguration. His clothes became as white as the light. So Peter, James, and John, who were with him at the time, are taken back. They have to be. You know, what is happening here to Jesus as we stand on this mountain in private? Just then, as if that were not enough, just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And you guys, Moses and Elijah are Old Testament characters, persons who have been gone for hundreds of years. But all of a sudden, they are there with this transfigured, shining Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I'll put up three shelters, One for you, one for Moses, or one for Elijah, a shrine almost. And while Peter was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them. And a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. You guys, there's a lot happening on what is known as the Mount of Transfiguration. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. You guys, this again is referred to as, you know, the experience on the Mount of Transfiguration. And it involves something that I've been noticing a lot more, just because shortly after we covered this on a Wednesday, my wife and I were privileged to take a bus trip by one of the local churches, and we went down to Washington, D.C., where we were able to visit the Museum of Bible History. The Museum of Bible History. Have any one of you been there yet? The Solaires have been there. Okay, the rest of you have a real treat coming to you when you get yourself there. Okay, now it is right downtown. And it's a six-story building that takes up a block. And it's all devoted to the history of the Bible. Okay, very specific. It is that's what it is. It's the history of the Bible itself and its impact in so many ways in our world. Okay? So there's six stories. As a matter of fact, the day that you go, plan on not seeing everything, because if you try to see everything, you're just going to be beat up. Okay? Enjoy part of it and come back another time and enjoy the rest of it. But in one of the floors, I forget which one, we walked into a section where it had Bibles from different time periods. Okay? So the one that was very much attracted my attention was the Bibles from the Middle Ages, when the printing press had just kind of started and books started coming out in mass, and a lot of it was simply Bibles. And I'd seen them at different times. I'm not sure where in my life, but I saw the illuminated Bibles. How many of you have ever seen a Bible and it's super colorful? And it has like artwork throughout the pages. Have you ever seen pictures of those or noticed that, hey, what is up with, you know? If you see a Bible from a certain time period, they are referred to as illuminated Bibles. And that jumped out at me. I mean, they combined God's word, and it was, you know, Renaissance period, kind of rebirth, and art made a resurgence, if you will. And they combined the two. And you have these things referred to as illuminated Bibles. You guys, in the story that we just read, and a lot did happen, but you have a lit up Christ. You know, no one knows exactly what, but the description is somehow of an illuminated Christ. And then these personages, these Moses and Elijah, that show up. Folks, and we can get into a lot of it, but I actually want to focus on, and you've been seeing it all the last several weeks, and you'll see some more before the season is over. And that is the stress on light. There is an emphasis at this time of year on lights, is there not? The transfiguration is the Father's way of emphasizing Jesus to the disciples and consequently to future disciples. The idea that Moses and these gentlemen were Jewish in faith, and Moses is a main character of the Jewish faith. He is the one through whom God brought the law. The law was a revelation. It was a light of what God wanted from the Jewish people. It was further revealed what God wanted to the Jewish people by people known as prophets. And hence that expression, the law and the prophets, were used by God to illuminate what God wanted. At the Mount of Transfiguration, you have Moses, you have Elijah, but you now have a new light. And that is Jesus Christ. And when they fall down and, not sure what to do, Jesus touches them and says, get up. And it's Jesus only that's there. And the voice that was in the cloud said, this is Jesus, listen, this is my son. Listen to him. In other words, it was the greatest revelation of God to us. Jesus Christ. So I go to this past Friday to the American Music Theater. How many of you know where that's at? American Music Theater. Okay, that's in Lancaster, right on Route 30. Cracker Barrel to your left. Across the street is a nice theater called American Music Theater. And you guys, they put on Broadway quality shows there. And it's really convenient for us because you don't have to go to New York. And how many of you know where Sight and Sound is? Okay, it's in that area, but it's much smaller. And you don't have to fight the crowd. And it's easy in and easy out. And they have some very nice shows, but they have a Christmas show. You guys, and it is so well done. But you know, the bottom line is, it was a lot of things to see and a lot of things to hear. And a lot of the seeing had to do with lights. And last night we were privileged and we went to Luminature. How many of you know what Luminature is? Oh, good. Some of you have heard of Luminature. It is what the Philadelphia Zoo is calling their light show, which was very spectacular. If you've ever gone to the zoo, but the animals were sleeping. There were no animals hardly to be seen. But a tremendous light show. Folks, keep noticing the connection between light and Christmas. As a matter of fact, those of us with our nice Christmas, you know, red and green, and there's a brightness. Amen. It speaks to the humanity of Christ, the red. that he became flesh and blood. But it's also, Sister Sally has a very nice one there. Amen. They start getting flashy. Sally, go ahead and stand up if you don't mind. Go ahead and show. Yes, look at that. And there's a flashiness, you guys, to our Christmas tree. You know, the glass bulbs and stuff, and the tinsel. But you know what really sets it off? It's meant to accentuate light. I want to talk to you for a couple minutes here about the true Illuminati. The true Illuminati. Let me read the Christmas story of John, the Gospel of John, to you real quick. From John chapter 1. Though you might not recognize it as a nativity story, it is his version of the nativity story. Listen to this. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, and this he, you guys, I'm going to tell you now, it's Jesus. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. And in him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And there was a man sent from God whose name was John. This is John the Baptist. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. John the Baptist was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Folks, that's John's explanation about whom Jesus Christ is and how he came into our world. It is a version of the nativity story. But it has such an emphasis on this aspect of Jesus Christ, the light. Again, the true Illuminati. John chapter 8 and verse 12 tells us, Jesus declared it, spoke again to the people. He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. You guys, we need to see Jesus for whom he is. He is the true Illuminati. Now, how many of you have heard that term? Illuminati. Ah, yes. Some older folks, some younger folk. Quick history lesson on the Illuminati. All right? It says here, depending on who you ask, the Illuminati are either a myth or a gigantic international organization that controls the world. Neither belief is actually true. The Illuminati were a real organization with lofty aims, but they dissolved centuries ago. And according to historians, they never were much of an influence. Today, conspiracy theorists think they are responsible for wide-ranging events, including the birth of the United States and the cover-up of alien visitors. In reality, they are a historical curiosity that has become entrenched in pop culture. Okay. The word Illuminati is Latin for revealed or enlightened. And that's why I'm referring to Jesus as the Illuminati. Because at the Transfiguration, oh, he was enlightened. He was full of light. But you know what? That's always been his nature. Several organizations dating to the 15th century used some form of this name, Illuminati, which looks a lot like the word illuminate, okay? One example was the Spanish alumbrados. You like the way I say that? That's how you should say that, alumbrados. You know what alumbrados means? Enlightened. All lit up. Okay? The Spanish, Spain had a version of these folks whose leader was a renowned prophet and mystic. The church considered the alumbrados to be heretics. They were persecuted under the Inquisition, which was never very pretty, the Inquisition. But their ties to mysticism made them almost antithetical to later Illuminati. So the way they practiced this idea of enlightenment is contrary to how future Illuminatis describe themselves. But their existence may explain why people think Illuminati exists far back in history. So now we have Bavarian, which is part of what we would call Germany. I had to look that up. Illuminati was founded in 1776 by Adam Weishaupt, and is the organization most people refer to when they talk about Illuminati as an organization. He was born in 1748. Weishaupt was educated by Jesuits and went on to become a professor. Although outwardly respectable, Weishaupt felt restricted by the conservative society he lived in and believed that the church and the monarchy were repressing free thought. His ideas could not be spoken of openly, so he started a secret society, inviting five of his most promising students to be founding members. Weishaupt was the only non-clerical professor in this institution that was run by the Jesuits. And he became very anti-clerical, and the Illuminati sprang up from his wish to spread Enlightenment ideas such as reason, philanthropy, and the separation of church and state. He wrote that his thinking offered freedom from all prejudices and would cultivate social virtues and animates them by a great, feasible, and speedy prospect of universal happiness. You know, that's what he was shooting for. Of course, let's see, the new Illuminati members were required to be wealthy, have considerable family and social connections. It was expected that the influence of the Illuminati's ideas would help reshape society as these members took positions of power. Some believe that the Illuminati actually wished to rule the world. At the very least, they were anti-royal and anti-church and wanted self-rule for the people of Europe. These ideas were similar to those that influenced the American and French Revolution. They were deeply steeped in ritual. Each member took a secret name. Listen to this. All the initiates, in other words, all the new members, were younger than 30. As those older were thought unable to adapt to new ideas. The organization recruited members of the elite of many European countries. They also infiltrated the Freemasons, which is another secretive society, both to recruit and get ideas for their own organization. At the organization's height, they had between 650 to 2,000 members. So that's not a lot of people, folks. And the members were paranoid with spy-like protocols to protect their identities. And it describes that was probably right, because if they had been found out, they probably would have been persecuted. Conspiracy theories about the organization sprang up soon after their dissolution, after they dissolved, okay? In America, these were encouraged by the letters Washington wrote addressing the Illuminati threat. But Jefferson defended Weishaupt, which led to accusations that he was a member. Many of the conspiracies of the New World were tied to the Freemasons, as both founding fathers and Illuminati were considered Freemasons also. And the placement of the Eye of Providence, that eye with the triangle that's on your dollar bills, is a well-known Freemason symbol on you, has helped keep these conspiracy theories alive. Popularity of the Illuminati conspiracy theories for today stems from the 1960s when two men, Robert Wilson and Carrie Thornley, thought that the world was becoming too authoritarian and wanted to encourage free thought. So they sent letters to Playboy with stories about the Illuminati. And each letter gave conflicting information, which forces readers to question what to trust. The two later wrote the Illuminatus Trilogy, which claimed the organization was behind many world events, including the assassination of President Kennedy. You guys, and that is inclusive of now comic books have picked up on that historical, you know, secretiveness and controlling the world and right? There's some superheroes connection now to this idea of, but the idea is simply of being enlightened. Amen. How many of you would like to be enlightened? Sure, folks, because we tend to think of it as a positive thing. As Christians, we know the true Illuminati. We know God's light. Amen. He came to this world. In the nativity narrative, there's light all over the place. Because light has come into the world through Jesus Christ. It speaks to life for us Christians. God's first pronouncement, his first words that he uttered that we are aware of are what? Let there be light. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 and 7 tells us, this is the message we have heard from him, referring to Jesus himself, and declare to you, God is light. Hallelujah. In him there's no darkness at all. And if we claim to have fellowship with him, with the light, with God, and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and we do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. We have fellowship with God, you guys, because God is the light. We have fellowship with God. And consequently, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. Hallelujah. So we say, bring on the light. Amen. Folks, for us to walk in the light is simply to become more Christ-like. And we talk about that. We stress that. We have been planted in Christ that we might grow in Christ-likeness. That we might connect to the body of Christ and take Christ abroad. Because the light has shone on us. And we need to spread that light. Amen? Let me just read one more verse from Matthew chapter 5. Because this idea, because I could go on a long time stressing the true Illuminati. Matthew chapter 5. Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount at one point will say this about us. About believers. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds, but ultimately glorify the Father in heaven. Folks, how many of you understand this connection a little bit, you know, between Jesus Christ, whom we're celebrating, the reason for the season, and the idea of light? So when you look at your Christmas tree and it's all lit up, you ought to think, God. That's why there's so much light associated with this season. But Jesus told us to share it. Do you realize that when you look up at night and you see what we call the moon, that you have never really seen the moon? Do you know what you're looking at when you look at the moon? And you see it all shiny up there? You're actually seeing the reflection of the sun, S-U-N, the sun, off this, you know, big rock up in this, in our firmament, and the light reflects off the moon and comes down here to this earth. And we perceive it to be light. But the moon is not like the sun. The sun is a big ball of gases, and it's on fire, and it actually produces light. But the moon is positioned in such a way that from our perspective, we see it lit up. Folks, can I tell you that unfortunately, we are not lights. Spiritually speaking, though we're being called to be lights unto the world, you know how we become lights unto the world? As we allow the light that is in us, in the form of Christ, to shine outwardly. You understand that? In other words, you just need to position yourself in such a way in regards to Jesus Christ, who is the light, can reflect off you, and other people perceive him. And that's why if you do a good enough job, they will not simply say, oh, you're such a nice person. They will understand that any niceness and any goodness is Christ being reflected through you. Folks, and that's the goal of Christianity, is to continue to perpetuate the light of God to the benefit of ourselves, because in darkness, you tend to hurt yourself a whole lot more. How many know that? Okay. That's why most of us like to walk in, and before too long, if it's a dark place, we want to find some light. Because, man, you can bump into stuff you don't want to bump into. Really? Okay? So we look for the light switch, or we look for a flashlight, or we look for our phones now. So it benefits us, you guys, to be found in the light. But beyond just that, is we are to be of benefit to others by positioning ourselves. God help us, because we all have a selfishness problem. Amen? I said amen. Folks, all of us are a little more selfish than we would like to be. And if you don't see it that way, it's just your lack of self-awareness. You need to walk in the light a little bit more. Folks, and we can join in as, and be among the illuminated ones because of the true Illuminati. which is Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's stand. So, folks, I have just been enjoying riding around. Amen. I like riding around on Route 1 just to go by Longwood Gardens. And look up and say, man, who took the time to put all them lights up? But I appreciate it. Amen. How many of you know that Hers Potato Chip Factory has a very nice display of lights, so you don't even have to get out of your car? We really like that. Folks, but let it remind us of Jesus Christ. And then let us reflect on whether or not we're reflecting Him as well as we want to, as well as He deserves to be. How much of myself can I get out of the way that Jesus might shine through? That's the way I think about it. You know, He is in me and He is the great light. How much of myself can I get out of the way so that people can see that light? Is a valid question. Folks, I hope you know Jesus Christ in a personal way. Because He's a guiding light. He is the guiding light. He's the only one that guides you all the way to life eternal. That's the Christian story. Amen. There are ways that seem right unto a man, but the ends thereof are the ways of death. That's what it says, the Bible says in Proverbs. And our world offers many alternatives. And there are people claiming, I am the Illuminati. I've got the answers to solve this world, the ills of this world. Folks, that claim belongs to Jesus Christ, thank you. And I know the true Illuminati. So I will continue to walk with Him. And walk in light and not in darkness. And try to shine that light to others. Amen. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer then. Amen. Lord, I thank You so much, Lord, for today. Lord, You have Your plans and Your purposes. Lord, I thank You for all the hard work, because I've seen our teachers and leaders, Lord, working with our kids, and they have a beautiful play, and that little play will happen, Lord, here in a couple weeks. And it'll shine the light of Christ also. But Lord, I thank You for a little bit of just maybe greater simplicity, Lord, in a time that sometimes gets so hectic. Lord, to simply remind ourselves that God is light. And in Him there is no darkness. And that if we claim to have fellowship with Him, but we walk in darkness, then we're lying to ourselves. Lord, I pray, dear God, that for each person that's here, Lord, that we would be clear that You are the true Illuminati. And that we would invite You into our lives. We would invite You into our hearts. Lord, that You would have Your way in every sphere of our life. Lord, that on a daily basis, Lord, You would illuminate the way for us. And Lord, that we would be used of You, Lord, not just to benefit from walking in the light, but dear God, that we might reflect that glorious light, Lord, and impact others, that they too might know You, O God. So Savior, with that, we thank You, Lord, and we praise You. Dear God, help us this week, Lord, to walk with You. Help us just to walk with You today, Lord. Keep shining Your light. Lord, sometimes it convicts us. Sometimes it needs to correct us. But whatever the case, Lord, we are thankful for light of life in our lives. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Folks, we will be here Wednesday night for our regular Bible study time. And otherwise, we'll see you all on Sunday. Merry Christmas to all. God bless you.